And we have liftoff. You can see already, one thing to point out, the telemetry that we can see at the bottom of the screen is actually really cool. But on the bottom left, you can see the number of engines that are firing, and actually one engine in the top right is not currently firing. Some kind of malfunction with that one. But the telemetry is something I'm just so impressed by, having access to this and not just the visual, which really helps in the parts where you can't really see as much on the cameras as we'll see later. But it's really cool because, I mean, watching space launches 20, 30 years ago or more, you've just got really the one kind of image for the most part. You don't have this like really impressive live telemetry, which is so cool to see. Now, so you can see on that there, the engine that on the right that is not firing, but then interestingly, on the just on the left opposite that engine, you can see an engine that is slightly throttled down. I am reliably informed this is what happened to try and account for the fact that its corresponding engine on the other side is not firing. On the right, bottom right image, actually on the bottom left, the bottom left as well, on the right side of that, you can see those kind of waffle shaped fins, and those are what they use to help keep it stable, but also to change its trajectory, especially when it's coming down. That lower stage is coming down to try and land and keep it vertical. Telemetry is pretty impressive. You can see the propellant reducing. When I was watching this live, I was really surprised at how little propellant the heavy lift lower booster stage was actually retaining for the re-entry. It really relied a lot on the atmospheric drag to slow its speed before that final firing of the engines for its splashdown in the water. Speed and altitude, of course, but also the fact that you can see the angle that the both the booster stage and the upper stage are at relative to the ground, which will be very important later, especially as the upper Starship stage comes in. And you can see on the right, none of the Starship engines are firing, of course, right now, because it's currently sitting on top of the booster stage there. But we're getting close to the point of separation where the booster stage will separate and come back down to Earth, and the upper Starship stage will keep going for a suborbital flight and then eventually landing just off the northwest coast of Australia if it is to survive. Hopefully no spoilers for you if you haven't seen this yet. But this is the fourth test, and if this Starship does manage to successfully re-enter and land, it will be the first time that it's done so. It's the fourth integrated test, the second of which was in November last year, and I actually did a video on that recently. But just quickly, we've got separation of the two stages. One thing I should have pointed out as we were doing this live is, as it was happening, is the Starship engines fire start firing just before it's fully separated, and so the top of the booster stage actually has a heat protection cap on it, which is to protect the top part of that booster stage from being cooked by the Starship engines as it separates away. Now the lower stage is still firing some of its engines, the inner two rings there, and this is what I was saying about how little propellant is remaining the LOX and the CH4 there, liquid oxygen CH4. How little propellant they retain for the final burn. It's that was really, really impressive to me. I mean, they're just really relying on the atmospheric drag. So the upper Starship stage is firing away on its own now, trying to get to that suborbital flight. Picking up some impressive speed. So now you can see the ring, the heat protection ring, floating away now from the lower stage. I believe that's because the lower stage is no longer firing its engines at this point. It's actually, so because it's been firing in retrograde, or firing, its engines are facing the direction that it's traveling rather than the other way around, that heat protection ring, I'm told, was actually stuck to the top of the booster. So what can I use as a prop here? If the booster is firing, it's coming down like this, and the engines are on the bottom right here, firing, and the heat protection ring is still here, so it's slowing down. It's slowing down its trajectory, and that ring, because it's the ring is going faster, so it's still being pushed into into the booster stage. And when those engines stopped firing, the ring kind of floated away, or so I'm told, at least by from the other streams that I've watched. So I just want to point out that I hope you can't hear any street noise. I've tried my best to set this up so that you can't. But unfortunately, the street noise has been pretty horrendous lately. I tried to wait for a time where it's a little bit quieter. Apologies, I'm looking at getting some better windows installed so that we can try and reduce this street noise. In any case, also just to point out, I've tried to make my face nice and small there on the left to keep the focus on the stream itself. I've left it on there just in case to try and reduce the risk of any copyright strike issues. All right, let's get back to the stream. That's enough about me. So the booster stage is now pretty much vertical on its way down, and that one will splash down, I believe, in the Gulf of Mexico, just in a few moments. But the upper Starship stage, I think I mentioned, will aim to splash down in the northwest of Australia, about roughly north of Exmouth off the west coast of Australia in the Indian Ocean. That will be quite a while away. Probably that would be in about an hour from now. But until then, it's still picking up speed, still firing its engines. You can see the booster stage now really bleeding off that velocity using the atmospheric drag. It's rapidly dropping its altitude, so we should see a splashdown on that one soon, assuming that goes well. In the second test, the booster stage actually exploded very shortly after separation, which was the subject of my most recent video. The speed, so impressive how that's dropping. You can see the waffle-shaped fin on the top left there, helping to guide its trajectory. Now the engines are firing, one engine not working. I think that was some parts of an engine flying off from the bottom there. Three engines firing now just for that final approach. And so impressive how little propellant they needed to slow that final speed. So now we have touchdown, engines off, and those flames igniting any trapped gases down at the bottom of the rocket, and then it tips over and splashes down, and you can see the SpaceX staff are obviously pretty pleased with that one. Meanwhile, the Starship upper stage is still firing its engines, still picking up speed, but getting pretty close to its coasting phase. We'll skip over the coasting phase and come back in where the re-entry begins, because there's about 30 or so minutes of pretty much no action, and actually the cameras will shut off at some point where they lose signal. Okay, signal is back, and we are starting to enter the atmosphere here with that upper stage, starting to get that atmospheric drag. You can just start to see the glow of the atmosphere on the leading edge of that Starship. Now, it's coming in at quite an interesting angle. It's using that the lower half, its belly, which has those heat protection plates, those little hexagonal grids you can see, to try and absorb as much of the heat as possible. And now, yeah, we see that lovely glow of the atmosphere there as it's starting to drop its altitude. The atmosphere starts to thicken up, and because of that massive speed that it's going at, 26,700 kilometers an hour, that's pretty fast. So that's going to start to get pretty hot as we get lower into the atmosphere. We just passed over 100 kilometers altitude. So we're probably somewhere over the Indian Ocean, maybe somewhere over Africa at this point. About 20 minutes away from intended splashdown now. One cool thing to point out is those hexagonal grids, heat protection grids there, those plates. SpaceX actually intentionally removed two of them from the belly and made one of them thinner, and I got a picture of that here as a test to see what happens if they do that. So I personally was surprised that they did that when they haven't actually had a successful splashdown yet. I would have thought they would have tried to do achieve that first before any kind of limit testing by taking off the heat protection plates. But there you go. And again, you can see just how little propellant is remaining for that final burn. They're going to really rely on the atmospheric drag to slow it down. We're down to about 91 kilometers and getting that lovely, lovely glow there. Let's skip ahead just a little bit. So the glow is starting to get almost like purple in color. Quite a fantastic sight, down to 77 kilometers, starting to slowly bleed off some speed, but it got a long way to go if they want to have a clean landing. Again, this would be the first time that Starship has successfully had an atmospheric reentry and landed in the water, if this were to succeed. Skipping ahead a bit more. So now we're at 68 kilometers, and you notice that the atmosphere, the altitude starts to drop a lot slower here. And really cool thing that I didn't expect to be so powerful was the atmospheric lift that Starship is actually generating here. Because of the way, the angle that it's coming in, and because of its because of its shape, it's actually creating some atmospheric lift, and that allows it to stay in that mid-atmosphere for longer without dropping too far, in order to bleed off as much speed as possible. Now, the drawback to that is, of course, it's going to get really hot, and hopefully the heat shields do its job. You can see one of the fins here, which would be so enormously hot if it wasn't for those protective plates, but we'll see how those hold up. Pretty cool sight. But we've got about at least five or so more minutes of this super hot re-entry. So we stay, you notice the altitude, as I said, is dropping a lot slower. We'll stay at this kind of roughly 65, 64 kilometer height for a little while. Skip ahead a bit more. Now we're starting to see some sparks, which would be some of the material of Starship actually ablating off because of the heat, which you don't want too much of that to happen, because it's actually eating away at the material of your spaceship here. Skip ahead a little bit more. So this is the really interesting part. So this fin has become kind of an internet meme, just because of the way it starts to fall apart. And there you go, you see chunks of it actually just being ripped away there, starting to expose the internal workings of that fin. But the fact that it held on for so long is quite impressive. I thought, okay, it's done now. It's over. There's too much of that fin missing. And in a moment, you'll see the camera starts to get kind of dark, because some of the metal being burnt off is actually coating the camera and covering our view. So unfortunately, we'll lose most of our camera view in a moment, but just look at that. You can just see the actual chunks of material flying off of that fin. That's so, so cool. But the fact that it's still holding on is just incredible. So we're down to 54 kilometers now, but look at that speed that it's dropping just from the atmospheric drag. Okay, here we go. We can see the camera now starting to get covered up by just the metal being coated onto it. Still just see some chunks of that fin being ripped away there. But it holds on, and we'll again just go ahead a little bit further. Down to 40 kilometers here, 7,500 kilometers an hour still, some speed to reduce. They did lose signal here. Not exactly sure why, perhaps because of the heat. Skipping ahead more, we've barely got any visibility, but that speed is massively dropped. 25 kilometers to go, so it's done its job. It's managed to use the atmosphere to bleed off all that speed to save fuel, and now it's starting to go nose down. Until this point, the nose has been up. All right, we'll stop skipping here. So now it's kind of just totally belly flopping. 9 kilometers to go, 570 kilometers now, still slowly dropping speed. So the final approach, and we'll see it in the telemetry, if not in the actual camera. The idea is they will flip around to almost vertical and start burning to reduce that final speed. Similar to with the booster stage, but with the booster stage, they were vertical already for quite some time. Here, they're still trying to shave off some speed by being as horizontal as possible. And I mean, just so impressive that fin, despite being so damaged, they're able to account for that and still keep it roughly horizontal. It is wobbling around a little bit, but we're 2 kilometers now. We should see that flip and burn very soon. 390 kilometers an hour, still dropping speed just from the wind drag. The air resistance. 1 kilometer now. And we'll see that flip and burn any second. Less than 1 kilometer, and there's the flip. The engines, I believe, would be firing. The telemetry's not showing it there, but the speed is dropping. And it's at a stable speed now, 20 kilometers, and we should have splashdown in just a second. Very hard to see anything that's going on here, but there we go. It's now flat and it's in the water and it has survived, which just an incredible thing to watch live. I really, really enjoyed watching this live. Of course, the SpaceX team having a good time there. That'll be the non-operational crew for this particular flight, watching the operational crew themselves behind that glass screen. One thing I want to point out, which I think is really cool, and Scott Manley mentioned this, but haven't seen anyone else actually point this out by looking at the flight radar, is now I swear I saw a map of where the fourth test that we just saw actually landed, but I can't find it now. But if we have a look at this was the planned trajectory of the third test, and I believe it landed roughly in the same place as, well, it would, if the third test had survived, it would have landed roughly in the same place where the fourth test did. Okay, so with that in mind, you can see it's going to be it would have landed just north of Exmouth off the west coast of Australia, Exmouth being that little point there. Maybe about between a third and half of the way to Indonesia. Okay, so with that in mind, let's take a look at this. I've got the flight radar for that exact time of landing, which would have been 1355 UTC, give or take a minute or two. Check this out. Roughly in that spot, north of Exmouth, about a third, between a third and a half of the way to Indonesia, we've got flight TGW9 from Perth to Singapore. Now, I don't know exactly how close it came. You have to assume it wasn't that close, because I know the airspace is big, but surely they wouldn't have let a plane get that close to where it was going to be coming down, just in case something went wrong. But you have to imagine there's a possibility that someone looking out the left window of TGW-9, this was at night, so any glow from that starship as it's coming down would have been a bit more visible than during the day. You have to imagine it's possible that someone saw this out the left side of the window. I mean, if I was on that flight, besides being a bit concerned about a starship coming down near me, I'd be looking out that left window. I'd make sure I had a window on that left seat, trying to get a glimpse of that, because that would be pretty cool sight to see. I did check. I haven't seen any. No one's taken a photo. No one's mentioned it from that plane on Twitter or anything else that I could see. Maybe it was too far away. Maybe it wasn't bright enough. But I think this is cool for me to think about, that maybe someone could have seen that. Anyway, thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed that. I had a great time watching this live yesterday, and I hope you enjoyed it as well. I hope you enjoyed this commentary, and we'll leave you there. Hopefully street noise wasn't too bad. I really apologize for that. I will get that improved soon. All right, take it easy. Bye.